you saved my life. Here I am. You see what?
Good morning, everyone. Wow, we are quiet this morning. We may have a bigger online presence or attendance this morning, but that's okay. We are so glad that you made it and that you are safe and that you are here. We got hot coffee, so make sure you stick around after and enjoy that and some fellowship together. If you are visiting or new here, special welcome to you. We would love to get connected with you. So if you would like to fill out a Connect card, they're located in the seat pocket in front of you. Make sure you fill that out and come say hi to us out at the Welcome Center. We'll have a gift for you for being here with us this morning. And we'd love to give you some more information about our church and what happens here and how you can get plugged in. Just a few things that are coming up. This Sunday, we are just taking a quick pause in our First Timothy series. We're doing a special missions focus this morning. So we have Scott Blackburn here. He is a longtime Emmanuel church family member, and we're so excited to hear about what God is doing through him and his wife Tracy in Peru. And so he's going to be sharing with us this morning. And Dave is also going to be sharing from God's Word and about him and Ty's trip to Egypt and Lebanon. So it'll be really cool just to hear what God is doing in the MENA region as well. So for our families, we're down a little in kids' community, so our elementary kids are in the service. If you didn't grab the coloring sheets and stuff out in the foyer, you can do that. But I think there's going to be lots of pictures, videos, and things that you guys can engage in this morning. Just a couple things that are coming up. You saw the video, The Gathering, our worship night with Cornerstone and Redeemer City Church is next Sunday at 6 p.m. Across the street over at Cornerstone Baptist. You are all welcome to attend. We would love for you to come and be a part of that as we all worship as three churches. Also, our Christmas Carnival is coming up on Saturday, December 10th. This is an afternoon event, 2 to 4 p.m. We'd love for you to come and be a part of it. It will just be a fun afternoon, lots of things going on to engage your family with, lots of fun activities. But what we'd love to encourage you with, this is an outreach-focused event. So we want you to come participate, but your mission is to bring somebody with you. Whether it's a coworker, whether it's a neighbor, a family member, a friend, that you can engage with and invite them to a church in a very non-threatening way. And we'd love for you to prayerfully consider who that person is you're inviting to that you can then engage with and maybe possibly invite them out to Christmas Eve after. So that's the mission behind it. It's going to be a lot of fun. We want your kids to have a lot of fun. There's obviously, you can see lots of treats and activities. You can bring gifts to get wrapped, the live animals, games, all that kind of stuff. But please, we encourage you, bring somebody with you. Also, the Muskoka Advent Choir is going to be here in this building on Sunday, December 4th at 7 p.m. This is a fundraiser for the Aurelia Pregnancy Resource Center, so there will be a free will offering taken at that event. There's no cost to attend, so come on out and enjoy some great Christmas music on that evening. And then also, I don't know if you've been around our cafe, we have a little table outside the cafe doors with some lost and found items. We're going to be sending those off to donate in a few weeks, so go check it out. A lot of it has been some Tupperware containers and things, so if you've given meals recently or brought something to the church, you may have left something behind. Go grab it before it's gone, and we'll appreciate getting that out the door. So thank you. We are so glad to worship with you this morning. I'm going to pass it off to the worship team.
Good morning, everyone. Glad to see everyone was able to make it in the snow. So Tyler wasn't able to make it today, so he just asked us to kind of step in and help out with some worship today. So I think we'll get started with that. So invite everyone to stand and join us with worship. And as the same, with every time that we're worshiping our God, whatever you need to do to make yourself feel comfortable, I invite you to do that. Whether that's to sing along, to take a moment to be silent and reflect, I encourage you just to do whatever it is you feel the Spirit's drawing you to do.
God who is, we worship the God who evermore. the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And he won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We were forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house.
To know you and to make you known.
To know you and to make you known. This is the anthem of our souls. Send us out and we will go. Anywhere you lead us. Drink my love till all I've learned, carry your name to the ends of the earth, carry your love and shine with your light till the whole world knows and lifts you high. Our eyes we set on Jesus. As a task you've laid before us, you voice we can't ignore. You said go into the nations as your final words to a broken world around us. Let us be your heart, oh God, to the unreached and forgotten. Let us be your healing arms. There's a task you laid before us, a voice we can't ignore. You said go into the nations as your final words.
My glory, my soul satisfied.
you. Thanks, team. We're going to go into a time of prayer. You can have a seat. I just want to encourage you before we pray that if you're wanting to give this morning, you can use those QR codes in the seat pockets in front of you, or we have the joy boxes in the back that you can use as well. Let's just go to God and just pray for those in our church family this morning. Father God, we just want to praise you this morning, God, for waking us up, God, for getting us here safely. And Father God, even in the reminders that you give us through things like your creation, God, we can see your hand, whether it's the changing of seasons, whether it's a new day, God. Father, I pray that we would be reminded, God, that you are in control of all things. Father, as we come to you this morning and bring needs before you, Father, I pray that you would just remind us of that truth, God, that you, despite what is going on in our lives, despite the things that we're facing, despite the trials, the questions, the hurts, the struggles, God, that we would know, Father, that you are still God, that we can be still and know that and trust you with the things that we have going on in our lives. And so, Father, we just want to lift up specific people in our church family this morning. God, we want to continue to pray for Rob and Dan this morning. God, we know that they're facing the same but different battles. And God, it is so easy for us to turn our eyes on the things around us and lose sight of you. God, I pray that this morning you would just encourage their hearts, that you would allow them to see you, be reminded of the peace that you give us even amongst the storm, that they would feel your presence around them. And God, that you would give them hope. Father, we thank you that because of Jesus, you have given us much to be hopeful for, even when things look bleak. God, we just want to continue to trust you, the great physician, with their bodies, with their health. And God, we ultimately want to give you the control. And so, Father, we pray for peace. We pray that you would just surround these families this morning with your presence. God, we pray for Verna, we pray for Annie, we pray for the extended family as well. God, there's so much around this that can be tough, but God, you have the answers that we need, and God, I pray that we would seek you first, that we would trust you. God, we want to uplift our junior highs. God, we thank you for getting them safely up to Muskoka Woods this weekend and for just the opportunity that these kids have had to be able to just grow in community together as a youth group, to be able to have a lot of fun, and ultimately to be able to be challenged in your word this weekend as well. God, as these kids are in their last session this morning, Father, we pray that we would see students with hearts that are open, ears that are listening to hear what you have for them this morning. God, we pray that we would see these kids come back encouraged and challenged and on fire and ready to live out their faith. Father, we thank you for Dan and for the leaders and just for the opportunity that they've had to just be able to invest this time with them. We want to pray for their travel mercies, for parents who will be going up to pick them up today, and for them coming home. We ask for safety for them. And God, we thank you for what you are doing around the world. God, we thank you for Scott and Tracy, for just the heart that you have given them to care for young kids who need to know the hope that is found in Jesus. God, I pray that you would continue to give them strength, continue to give them resilience and endurance. Father, they have a difficult task, but you have equipped them so well. God, I pray that they would know the strength that they have in you, and that you continue to use them to be hands and feet that allow kids to truly encounter Christ through them and know what true love is. And Father, we thank you for that. Pray that you would bless Scott this morning as he shares with us. God, we want to lift up our global partners as well and what you're doing around the world. Father, we're excited to hear through Dave what is going on in the MENA region. And we want to continue to lift up Rashara. We want to continue to lift up Gus. And we thank you for how you are at work around the world. God, I pray that you would just continue to remind us, prompt us to be able to pray for these people, to be able to continue to uplift them, to encourage them, to find ways that we can be a part of what they are doing and live on mission for you. And God, I pray that for us, that you would remind us that, God, we have a mission field right here. Father, there's people all around us that are in need of the gospel. God, I pray that we would be your hands and feet wherever you've placed us, that we would feel that calling on our lives to be able to extend your love to others and to be able to show them who Jesus is. Father, would you give us names of people that we can invite out to the Christmas carnival, to Christmas Eve, to be able to have people hear the message of hope, of what Jesus did for us, and how they can have that assurance. Father, for the remainder of this service, God, we want to give you all the praise and the glory. We pray that you would speak through Scott, speak through Dave. Would we have ears to hear this morning, and would you encourage us this morning? Father, we love you. We thank you for this time, and we pray this all in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's I'm in the company of the brave right here. This is unbelievable. Thank you so much for coming. And for those of you who are tuning online, we are so grateful for you as well. Hey, before we get going, just two things. Just want to let you know we are praying for Dave Hurley as well. He's been going through cancer as well. And so we just want to remind you to keep praying for him. He's doing 2 weeks of isolation after doing a round of radiation. So you can be in prayer for him. And the Horners, we are praying for your mom. I was going to say Trudy, Lori, for Vi. We're praying for your mom as she is obviously in the hospital, and we truly do care for you guys and want to support you through this. So it's a little bit different Sunday this morning. I don't know if you've noticed that, not just because of the snow, but because we are doing a missions Sunday. We are pushing pause on our 1 Timothy series. We're going to pick it up. We have one more sermon left in our 1 Timothy series. We're going to pick that up. Russ is going to share with us next week what that last message is. However, this morning, what I want us to do is focus our hearts and our attention on two things. Want us to focus our hearts and attention on what God is doing around the world. And then also, I want to challenge us to ask the question, God, what are you asking me to do? What are you calling me to do? And how do I partner with you with what you're doing around the world? When we launched this church 7.5 years ago, can you believe it? 7.5 years ago. But when we launched this church 7.5 years ago, one of our greatest desires was to be a church that was relentless in mission. We truly wanted to be a church that was relentless in mission. We wanted to be a church that reached beyond these walls to see people come to place their faith in Jesus Christ. That's why we partnered with organizations with the Lighthouse. That's why we've partnered with the Aurelia Pregnancy Resource Center. That's why we partnered even with places like the Jubilee House and Greenhaven here inside of this city. That's why we've partnered with local schools and why we have made a plea for coats and other things along the years that we've been here. That's why we have launched out even Talia Knight into going to Poland. That's why we love Jen Mountney, who is a part of Youth for Christ. And if you want to know more about Jen Mountney and Youth for Christ, she's got some cards here. She's going to be sharing a little bit next week. We're going to do a mini interview with her next week so you can hear a little bit about that. That's why we may even have another missionary coming up. We'll see. You may stay tuned for that. But we are a church that wants to be relentless in mission. One of our greatest desires is we want to join with God what he is doing around the world. We don't simply want to be a church that comes here week in and week out, enjoy a service, and then go and live the next 6 days. And then come back and enjoy service, then go and live another 6 days, and then come back and enjoy service and live the next 6 days. We truly want to be a church that lives as missionaries inside of the context of this city and our region. And also what we want to do is join with what God is doing around the world. Why? Why is this such an important thing for us? It's because we see that God has called us to join him with what he is doing around the world in people's lives. And he wants to use us as a billboard. He wants to use us to point people to a saving faith in Jesus Christ. And one of the ways that we do that here is to live as missionaries. We need to live as missionaries here. What that means is that how we interact with people throughout our week, it really matters. How we love people that are around us, it really matters how we do that and how we do that well. How we spend our money and how we spend our time, it really matters. How we raise our kids, how we love our spouse, these things all matter in the big picture. How we make decisions and what those decisions point to, it really matters. And how we live and what defines our life, it really matters. Our love for Jesus and our desire for others to encounter him, it really matters. And we ought to live our lives in such a way that our lives are a billboard where people will encounter Jesus Christ through us. And that's why we want to be relentless in mission. Why? Because God has called us to this task. If you have your Bibles with you, very quickly, grab them. Turn to John chapter 20. John chapter 20. This is a small little message before I call up Scott up here when we do an interview with him. But John chapter 20. We are going to see this. I could take you to a lot of different places this morning, but I want to show you what Jesus says in John chapter 20. Here's the context as you are turning there. Jesus has just died on the cross. And in many ways, so did the hope and the expectation of the disciples. I mean, their leader was gone. Their Savior had died. The Messiah was killed. And how were they going to carry on? How were they going to continue to move on in their ministry? Who was going to lead them? What were they going to do? However, what we see here in John chapter 20, in a miraculous turn of events, when Mary Magdalene went to Jesus' tomb after he died, she saw that the stone had been rolled away, the stone had been removed. And in a shock, she ran back to the disciples. She found Peter and John, you'll see in John chapter 20, and she told them everything that she saw there at the empty tomb. And when Peter and John heard this, they took off running. I mean, they flew all the way to the tomb. They ran to the empty tomb, and when they arrived, sure enough, the stone had actually been rolled away. However, for them, they weren't shocked. The Bible tells us in John chapter 20 is what we see is that when they saw the empty tomb, the Bible says that is that they believed. In other words, when Peter and John heard this, they remembered, or when they saw this, they remembered what Jesus had said to them. The words of Jesus came back to their minds, that he was going to suffer here in this world and that he was going to die on the cross for the sins of the world. And after dying, he was in fact going to rise again after 3 days. All of these things came flooding back into their mind. And it was there in that moment when they saw the empty tomb, seeing that the stone had been rolled away, seeing that the tomb was empty, it was there. There in that moment, they believed. They knew that their Savior was alive. They knew that he had risen from the grave. They knew that Jesus' mission was complete. However, there was one last thing that Jesus needed to do. And so when Peter and John left that empty tomb, they went and found all of the other disciples, and they began to share with the other disciples what they had just seen. And it was in this moment when Peter and John were telling the disciples what they had just seen, Jesus showed up. And when Jesus showed up, he told them something. And this is what he told them. In John chapter 20, verse 19, it says this: on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together With the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you." Now, I want you to notice what Jesus said next, the very next words of Jesus. Because it is in these next words that ought to change the way we live our life and how we view our lives. Jesus says, "Peace be with you." And then he goes on and he says in verse 21, "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them, which is not COVID protocol here, but he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." In other words, Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, Guys, in just the same way that God the Father sent me into this world on a mission, in just the same way, in many ways, that my mission was to go and die on a cross and declare salvation, that salvation is found in no one else other than the name of Jesus in me, I am now sending you, just like the Father has sent me. In other words, in just the same way that I entered into broken humanity, and into people's lives. And in just the same way that I taught people who I was, and in just the same way that I demonstrated the kindness and the grace and the patience of my Father to this world, and in just the same way that I declared to this world that salvation is found in no other name other than the name of Jesus, so it is with you guys. It is now your turn. It is now your job to carry on what I have started. It's your job now to enter into broken humanity, into people's lives. It is now your job to teach people who I am. It is now your job to demonstrate grace and kindness and the patience of God to this world. It is your job now to declare that salvation is found in no one else other than the name of Jesus. And what is true to the disciples here in John chapter 20 is so very true to us here this morning in 2022. We have a job to do. We have a job to do, and that is to live as missionaries and to offer those around us and those around the world the hope of salvation that is found in no other name than Jesus. And so this morning, what I want to do and what we want to do is I want to introduce you to someone who is living this out in a real and radical way. And how he and his family and his son is here this morning right there. He's dancing kind of there in between the horns there. But how he and his family are living on mission in Peru. And then I want to share with you how Emmanuel is engaging in global missions. I want to share with you what Ty and I experienced when we went to Lebanon and Egypt. And then I want to challenge you once again with the words of God. But before I call Scott up, I want to encourage you to watch this video and learn a little bit about their ministry and their mission in Peru. And then I'm going to interview Scott, and you're going to hear what he's doing down there. Check out this video. Thank you.
Uno, dos, tres. Go Bruce! Go Santi! Go Yuri, go. Where's Brianna?
So I have on the stage with me Scott Blackburn. Scott is married to Tracy Morning. Blackburn, and he has Jackson as one of his sons, and then Caleb is another son who's in Barrie or wherever he's in right now. Would you just give a warm welcome to Scott? Scott, I have four questions. Really, you gave me the four questions, but these four questions will allow us to get to know you and the ministry that you're doing down there and even what propelled you to go down in the first place. So the floor is yours, but the first question is this. Tell us a little bit about the Blackburns, your life, and maybe even what led you.
Hey, quickly, I want to shout out to the kids because they've been watching.
Yeah.
Buenos dias todos, te extraño mucho. So we're the Blackburns. We came to know Christ through the Alpha program at Emmanuel Barrie about 20 years ago this fall, actually. Worked in lay ministry through the Alpha program and the Alpha marriage course for several years. Reader's Digest version in 2014, we got a call to move to Peru. It was a bit of a process. We had a successful business here, homes, everything we needed, and our daughter did a missions trip to an orphanage in Haiti that year and came home and basically said, I'm leaving. As soon as high school's over, I'm going to go find somewhere to serve Jesus. So as a family, that drew us all together to look more closely at what that full-time missions looked like. Basically, in 2014, we sold everything. About 6 months, we left and moved to the southern Amazon jungle in Peru. Not to that place, to a different place. We opened a home that our first organization had run, a girls' rescue home, very similar to the work we do now. We worked there for 4 years, came back in 2018 on a furlough, got fired from our missions organization. Yes, missionaries do get fired. It was a great time of growth for us. A good friend of mine sent me an email, simply said, thanks for the promotion, and he was 100% correct, because it was a great promotion. Went back to Peru in 2018, really seeking the Lord's will. You know, were we to continue there? He made it evidently clear we were able to open an association, our new association, our own NGO, within 3 months, and that's usually a year and a half process in Peru. So just showed us pure favor. Got our new association opened up in July of 2018. Got taken on by a new organization who we're with now. Then they were Missionary Ventures Canada, and now it's Impact Hope. August of that year, our oldest daughter, Tatiana, was on vacation out west with her fiance. They got engaged. They were traveling back. She was killed in a car wreck. Came back from Peru. Dealt with that for 3 months. Went back to Peru. really encouraged by some good friends in Texas, some supporters in Texas, and to buy land and build Tat's place, and that's where we are now in the video.
And so tell me a little bit about Tat's place. Tat's place is named after your daughter, who passed away.
So Tat's place is it's a home for children that have come from very difficult circumstances. Some have been abandoned. Lots of physical abuse, sexual abuse. Just some cases that just shock us to our core. But it's a place where they come and they heal and they live full time. They live with us full time. We're like a big foster home, foster families. We've cared for 66 children in 6 years. We just had two more come in actually while I was home, one returning and a new one, Danny and Marisol. But you know, the kids are awesome. They just keep us alive, and they're just such a blessing to us. They're challenging, but they're a blessing in so many ways. God, the last 4 years, God's really taken us on this journey. And I know the journey was to define what Tat's Place was. We opened Tat's Place, we moved into Tat's Place in 2019, and we opened official opening in 2020. And the last few years, God's just been really defining what he wanted the ministry to be. And, you know, before that, we kind of, embarrassingly, we kind of picked and choose the cases we get, and maybe if they were too difficult, we might shy away from them or, you know, say no. And through the last couple of years, he's really driven us to the more difficult cases, and we didn't know what was going on at first, but it was, wow, like I'm convinced I've completely seen the darkest depth of the evilness of humanity, and these cases just shocked us to our core. But he wanted us to say yes, because what we realized through that is that everybody was saying no to these kids, and these kids weren't getting cared for. So he took us on this journey, but then he didn't keep us there. He moved us away from that, and he gave us the joy of taking this child that's been, just broken, and allowing us to, through us, him to heal that child and just be able to care for that child and love for that child. And it's awesome.
Yeah. So Scott and Tracy and Tat's place, as you hear, they look after kids and giving them spiritual needs, physical needs, emotional needs, care, all of these. And in a situation that is very unhealthy, they're coming out of an unhealthy situation. So first of all, thank you for doing that, showing them the hope that that is in Christ. Another question here is, how's God using Tat's place? And how can we, you know, in some ways pray for you? And I have another question that's not on here.
Sure.
Just so you know. So.
God just, you know, like I said, we get these kids and we're allowed to just love them and care for them and let them grow in a healthy environment, take them away from the environment that was harmful to them. And I can just highlight. Sorry. Betsabe came to us. She was 10 days old. She was abandoned in the hospital. Mom has a drug problem. She had syphilis when she was born. She was 3 pounds when she came to the house. And it was unbelievable. We'd never had a baby that small. And I didn't sleep for 2 weeks. I was like making sure she was breathing every night. And we were able to get some milk fortifier from Lima and bring that up and just really help her get strong. And she was really weak when she came in. But we could see, you could see in her eyes that there was something going on there. And that's her 11 months now. She's awesome. She should be going to Lima with her grandmother shortly. She has an awesome grandmother in Lima, and it's a great opportunity for family reunification, which we love, but she's going to be a hard one to say goodbye to. But.
Before you tell us what we can pray for you about, this is not on the script here, so I'm putting you on the spot, okay? You mentioned in the beginning, the first question, you left a successful business, and I know you left a successful business. Mm-hmm. And you left everything behind here in Canada to go and do this. That was a major faith risk for you and your family. Any words of encouragement or any words for us? Obviously, not all of us have been called to do that. But what would you say to us here in Canada? Any words that you could say to us as far as living with that faith risk?
Yeah, I was told I couldn't do it. I was told by senior pastors that we couldn't do it, and we weren't formally trained. Never been to Bible school. I'm not your cookie cutter missionary. My wife wasn't on board when we first started talking about this. In fact, we had a huge argument about the whole thing, and then the Holy Spirit just started working through her and working through our family, and it was just a matter of say yes. You know, when Jesus is calling the disciples in Luke, and he says, and the one disciple says, "Oh, I want to go bury my father," and the other one says, "I want to go say goodbye to my family." What's Jesus say? He says, "Oh no, someone else could do that." So the whole point is just say yes, go, and go fast. And we did that, and that's why we received some opposition from pastors, because, you know, the North American way is, you know, you got to be trained and you got to do all this stuff, and you don't have to be. We've been there 8 years now, and God has used us in just amazing ways, and we're just so blessed to be able to serve. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have, you know, training, and there are advantages to that, but God can use anybody. You know, we're the clay and he's the potter, and he shapes us to what he wants to be. And all the challenges we've been through, you know, with Tat dying and leaving a one organization and going to the, those were major. 2018 has got to be the most highlighted year of our life, you know. And but through that, God grew us, and he shaped us to where he wanted us to be. And he has us in a place now where it's just awesome. Yeah. But you can do it. Say yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to pray for you. Yeah. But how can we pray for you? And yeah, not just right now. How can we pray for you continuing from this place?
Yeah, obviously pray for the kids that God brings to us. We don't know case by case. We don't know, you know, who's coming next. Two kids have come since I came here. So just pray for those children. Pray for our spiritual discernment and our wisdom as we care for them and meet them, their needs, where they need to be. Pray for additional medical. Actually, just before I left, we have a burn victim. Excuse me, that came into the house, and she's about 20 months old, and she got burns to about 30% of her body, and again, another drug alcohol problem where the mother pulled her out of the burn hospital in Lima early, so we're dealing with that on her care, continuing care. Pray for Esme, pray for Betsabe, she might be leaving soon. Pray for Tracy, she's down there slugging away in the heat today. Thank you so much. Jackson and I travel back on Tuesday. There was just a big plane wreck in Lima, too. I think they got the airport open this morning or yesterday. So we're hoping our schedule doesn't get messed up. But, yeah, just continue to play for the kids. The kids is the biggest part of the ministry.
Yeah. Hey, on behalf of Emmanuel Total, but more specifically on behalf of Emmanuel here in Aurelia, I just want to say thank you. Thank you to you and to Tracy. I've known you for 18 years. I love your faith. I love your risk. I love the fact that you live your days right now in just this complete dependency on God. And thank you for doing what you're doing and loving these kids the way that you do. And I want to pray for you right now. Would you just join with me in praying? And then we'll carry on. Father, we do thank you so much. Thank you for Scott. I thank you for Tracy. I thank you for Jackson and Caleb. And I know, Father, many people here in this room, they don't know the Blackburns. They were able to get a glimpse of their story, what you've done in their life. And I pray that would stir us. I pray that would stir us as a church to see that you are calling us to live a sent life. You are calling us to live as missionaries. Some of that is here in Aurelia. Some of that is here in this region. And some of that is you're going to call us to live overseas. God, I pray that you would help us to hear Scott and Tracy's story and that we would live this sent life, that we would live obediently to just saying yes to you. God, we do want to pray for the kids, the girls that are in this home. God, you know the situations that they were in. You know the situations that you rescued them out of. And I just pray that as they're there at Tat's place, that they would come to a saving faith in your son, Jesus Christ. And I pray that they would know that there is hope in Jesus. God, I pray that you would heal them. We know that many of these kids come with emotional scars that we cannot see. Scars that are deep, scars that are wounding. And so, God, I pray that you would use Scott and Tracy, their love, ultimately your love in their life, to allow them to know that there can be healing. God, we do pray
for even for this one child with the burn. We pray that you watch over her. God, we also pray for Jackson and Scott as they go back down to Peru on Tuesday. Lord, watch over their travels. Give them safe travels. Lord, I pray for the government and the country there in Peru. And we pray that you would allow them to continue to have favor in the government's eyes. Increase their influence in the government and increase their influence in those around them. And may you be honored through their ministry there in Peru. Continue to walk before them, lead them as a family, and go before this ministry. And we commit this ministry to you right now. And we pray these things in Christ's powerful name. Amen. Would you just give a thank you to Scott? I want to encourage you that if you want to talk more or ask more questions to Scott, he is going to be in the foyer after the service. He also dropped off this book right here, which will be in our library, our resource room, and their daughter's story is in this book. It is stories of loss and hope, and how to process through grief. Of not just a family member, but children. And so I want to encourage you, if you know someone, we will have this book here. If we need to get more, I'll find ways to get more from you. And there's some out there as well at the back. But I encourage you to find Scott and talk to him after the service. We're going to keep going. I want to share with you in the remaining time that we have. I want to do three things in the remaining time that we have. I want to share with you Emmanuel's mission strategy. Some of you are new. Some of you don't know that we have a strategy. We do have a strategy here. I want to share that strategy with you. I want to share a little bit, a minor report of Tyler and I's time in Lebanon and in Egypt. I'm going to share a video of that, and then I want to share just some challenging, some things that God challenged me with coming out of that trip. Just so you know, we have a vision here at Emmanuel to make strategic partners around the world. We call these global partners, and we want to invest in these global partners in a few different ways. You'll see on the screen up here, we want to invest in them financially. Some of you, when you give to Emmanuel, when you give to Emmanuel, some of that money goes towards our global partners. We want to financially support them so that they are equipped to do what God has called them to do wherever God has called them to do that. We also want to pray for them. We want to pray, come alongside of them, and pray that God would continue to use them. God would continue to use them to reach people. We want to encourage you as a family to pray for them. We want to encourage you as a missional community to pray for them, and we will pray for them as a church and throughout our various different ways. Another thing that we do for our global partners is we want to encourage them and care for them. It is hard being a missionary. You leave home. You leave the context that you're familiar with, and you're entering into a new culture. It's hard. And so we want to care for them. We want to encourage them. We want to call them, email them, FaceTime them, whatever it takes. We want to encourage them, and so we want them to know that we are supporting them as they are doing what God has called them to do. And we also, one last one, we want to send teams. Our heart's desire is that if you call Emmanuel your church home, if this is your church home, we would love for you to do a missions trip at least once in your lifetime. And we're going to try. COVID put a little stint in that, like a stop to that, a pause to that. But we want to encourage you. And we'll have trips throughout the upcoming years that you can take. And we want to encourage you to find ways in which you can take these trips and experience what God is doing around the world. We have three right now. We have three global partners right now. We are in search of more, but we have three global partners right now and three strategic areas in the world. The first one, you're going to be like, is that really a global partner? The first one is Quebec. And the reason we've chosen Quebec is because our denomination has identified Quebec as a place that is in our own backyard, in our own country, that has 0.9% evangelical churches. And so we have partnered with a church plant there that was planted 3 years ago. It's a church called La Cité, and their vision is to reach the university students and those who live in the Laval area. And we've partnered with a partner called, and his name is Jonathan. You can see his photo onto the screen. And so that is a global partner that we have. Another global partner that we have is in India. We are currently supporting a place called the Rupamari Tutoring Center through a man by the name of Gus, and that's his family on the screen that you can see behind me. The Rupamari Tutoring Center offers two opportunities for those living in the Sundarbans Islands. And just so you know, the Sundarbans Islands are a place in India where the gospel in some areas has not even touched. Some people in those islands have not even heard the name of Jesus. And so we've partnered with this organization, Rupamari Tutoring Center. Emmanuel is the only one supporting this tutoring center, and they do two things. They help children by gaining education, providing for them daily food and nourishment, provide emotional care and help, and also gives them an opportunity to hear the gospel. The other thing that they do is that this tutoring center on Sundays turns into a church, so that their parents could come and those in that area could come and be a part of a local church. And so that is one of our global partners. And another global partner that we have, our last one, yet we are still searching for more, but our last one is in the Meta region. If you don't know what the Meta region is, it's the Middle East, North Africa. It's a short form for that. Specifically, we are partnered in Lebanon, and we are partnered with a man by the name of Bakara Kirkafi, and that is him in the picture with his family. And what we are doing there is we are also partnering with a church planting movement there. And we've, for the time being, partnered with a man by the name of Camille, and he has planted a church to the Syrian refugees. And this is now where I want to just take a pause and share with you the trip that Tyler and I did a few weeks ago. Tyler and I went to Egypt, and then we flew to Beirut, Lebanon. And we did, in many ways, three different things in each one of those areas. Actually, two things in both of those areas, and then just one extra thing in Lebanon. When we went there to both Egypt and Lebanon, we did we held a pastor's conference. God is moving in the Middle East. I don't know if you've heard this, but God is moving in the Middle East in big ways. And we had the privilege of being able to teach at the pastor's conference there. This conference was a training ground for church planters who have launched churches and who are soon to be launching churches. You would be proud of Tyler. I got food poisoning, and so I couldn't teach one day. And so in the morning of that same day, just hours away before I was supposed to speak, I looked at Tyler and said, "Ty, you're up. You're going to preach." And he said, "I'm going for it." And he did a phenomenal job teaching these pastors. But we taught these pastors just what it means to plant a church, what it means to be the church. Here's what you need to know. In the area of the world where for many years the gospel was shut out and was not allowed to be proclaimed, God, in his mighty hand, has opened up the doors for churches to be planted and the gospel to be proclaimed. Churches are being planted almost daily in this area. And they are having a profound effect on people very quickly. I had the privilege of going up to the mountains just outside of Beirut. 2.5 hours away, they sent me, because that was my third time to Beirut, so they sent me alone up into the mountains. And in these mountains is where the Druze were, and also there was ISIS there. And so I went to this church, and I got talking to the pastor before, and he told me this story that there was one time that he got a phone call, or someone showed up at his church, and he wanted to ask questions. And so this man started asking questions, "What do you believe about Jesus?" And so this pastor started telling him unapologetically what he believed about Jesus. And as he was telling him, this man started to shake, and you could tell that he was getting really angry. And he got so angry that he said, I need to leave right now. And so he got up and he left, and the pastor said, that was interesting. A few days later, he got the man showed up at his place again, and he said, I need to talk to you more about Jesus. And so the pastor said, come on in and sit down. And this man began to ask more and more questions. He said, I've never heard this before. I've never heard someone speak of Jesus like this. As he was sharing, the pastor just felt compelled near the end and said, I think you're at a spot where you need to surrender your life to Christ. And this man said, yes, I do. In that moment, he surrendered his life to Christ. Right after that, this man said, I need to tell you something. I was sent here by ISIS to kill you. When I showed up here and I started asking you questions about Jesus, I was blown away by what I heard. I left because I was so compelled, I needed to know more. And then I came back, and what you were sharing about this man named Jesus, this person named Jesus, is unbelievable. And I'm going to leave ISIS and follow Jesus. I was talking with the pastor because he told me that this man was going to be at that service. And I asked him, I'm like, who is this man? I want to meet this man. And he's like, oh, you saw him. He was the one that was leading worship on Sunday morning. He was the one standing up and leading all of us in worship. I don't know why I did this. He wasn't doing this, but he was leading us. He was leading us in worship. God is doing amazing things. I'm telling you, there's churches being planted, and Tyler and I were able to be a part of training people to be able to plant these churches. We also got to participate in a prison ministry, both in Egypt and in Lebanon. We got to teach some prison chaplaincies there. And chaplains that were taking the gospel into people who were in prison and also their families who were left behind when these men went to prison. Here's what you need to know when a man goes to prison, much like here, but in worst case scenario, this has massive repercussions on the family's life. In many ways, this leads the family to immediate poverty and disparity. This poverty and disparity leaves this family without hope. Wives are left having to raise their kids with no availability to find work. So it's an instant doorway to poverty. Kids are left without their fathers and in many ways thrust into a life of perpetual poverty and trying to find ways to survive. And you can only tell what that would lead them to. We had an opportunity to sit down with these people and some of these families and some of these kids. And Tyler and I, get this, got to go into a prison in Lebanon. We were ushered in and we got to share the gospel with prisoners face to face. And then we were at a mom of one of the men that were in the prison. Ty and I went to a home visit. And as we were sitting down with this mom, it just became clear that she was so ready to receive Jesus. And so we asked her, do you want to place your faith in Jesus Christ? And she said, yes. And so Ty and I were able to lead her to understand what it means to place your faith in Jesus Christ. And she surrendered her life to Christ. And that gave her hope for her son. It gave her hope for her husband who were in prison. We also got to be a part of the Syrian refugee ministry in Lebanon. Just to give you a perspective here, you may not know this. There are 2.2 million people in Lebanon, in Beirut rather. Of that 2.2 million people in Beirut, do you know how many Syrian refugees there are? Just over 1 million. That's half of the population are Syrian refugees who are struggling for food, struggling for health, for housing, struggling for medical care. And we got to go into these homes and visit with these people. In many ways, they were living in the basement of these high-rises, in like the mechanical rooms of these places. And Sandy, you were there. I know that you saw some of these places as well. Tyler and I got to visit a Syrian refugee home and hear stories of the war of the murder and of the torture and the poverty of these Syrian refugees. There was one family that we got talking to, and Tyler and I visited, and whose father was murdered in Syria, which left the wife and two daughters without a husband and without a father and with no hope. The only way that they could survive was to flee Syria and seek refuge in Beirut, and they did that. And these two daughters really have no future and no possibility of escaping this poverty cycle that they're in, except for this ministry that we are connected with as a church in Beirut. This ministry in Beirut goes to them, provides them food, provides them care. It provides the kids a schooling so that they can get educated, that offers them hopefully a future. And do you know this? When we were over there, we got talking with Amanda, who's our kids' community director. And right now, we are supporting those two girls whose father was murdered by the Syrian in the Syrian refugee crisis. And we are, as a kids' community, supporting both of those kids. And I think our first month is already raised. And we get to provide hope for these kids by financial support and care. And so we got to see what God is doing there. However, there's churches in Lebanon that are being Christ's hands and feet, an extension of God's grace and love to these refugees. We're a country where in many ways a country has ignored them and forgotten about them, and a religion called Islam that has in many ways abandoned them. It is the church of Jesus that is extending grace and care and support, and are feeding them, and are starting schools for them, and finding them employment, and churches that are sacrificing their time, their own money, to care and help the Syrian refugee crisis there. I'm going to show you this video that Ty shot while we were in, not shot, filmed, I should say. It's a different story, I guess, in Lebanon when you say shot, but what Ty filmed in both Egypt and Lebanon, it gives you a little bit of a glimpse of what we got to do. And I'll come back up here and challenge us on the way out. Thank you. kind of gives you a little bit of a glimpse visually of what it's like in Egypt and also in Lebanon. I got to tell you that coming back, that was my third time in Lebanon, coming back, the Lord taught me some valuable lessons by being over there once again. And I want to share just two of those lessons with you. It's not long. They're not long. But I want to just share the last remaining minutes, just two lessons that God challenged me with that I hope that will challenge you in how you live out this sent life. First challenge that I was reflecting on the trip and just what I saw was this. I saw the love of Christ on display through this church and in God's people. I know that sounds easy to say, but I saw the love of Christ on display through this church and in God's people. And what I mean by that is this. This church, these Christians, were living in such a time that they were willing to give up, in many ways, everything to be able to be proclaimers of Jesus Christ. It was this love and compassion that was opening up doors and giving these gospel opportunities. It was the church loving other people. Can I ask you this? Why is there such a spiritual revival going on and a spiritual awakening happening in the MENA region? Obviously, God's Spirit is at work. So it's obviously on God on that. But can I tell you one of the reasons why I think that there's a spiritual revival and there's a spiritual awakening that's happened? It's because the church is looking out beyond their own lives and loving people, loving their enemies. Here's what you need to know that you may not know. Many of the Syrian refugees who are coming to Lebanon are coming from the Muslim religion. And when they arrive, they are looking to their religion, Islam, and their people for care. They're looking for their own religion and their own people to provide for them, to reach out to them, to care for them, to support them. And what they are finding in their own religion and in their own people is that they are experiencing a hollow religion and a critical people and an uncaring spirit. Oftentimes, they are being ignored and forgotten by their own people and their own religion. However, it is the church there. It is a church that we support through Emmanuel here. It is a church that are the ones that are supposed to be enemies. They're seen as enemies, but it is a church that is reaching out and caring and loving and providing for their needs in a desperate time when people have little hope and don't know where to turn. Because of the economic crisis that is in Lebanon and because of the Syrian refugee crisis that is happening, it is the church that is living beyond its walls, is noticing these people. It is showing kindness and grace and sacrificing in many ways their own salaries, their own livelihood, so that they can be Christ's hands and feet to a people who in many ways are their enemies. But church, isn't that what it's supposed to be? This is what convicted me. Isn't that how we're supposed to live? I mean, isn't that what Jesus said in Luke chapter 6? Check out this verse in Luke chapter 6. Jesus said this: love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, turn to them the other also. If someone takes your cloak, do not withhold your shirt from them. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. In verse 35, love your enemies. Do good to them. And lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great. And you will be children of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. One of the greatest lessons that I walked away from is that there is a church there that is seeing the vast need And they are reaching out in Christ's love to these people, in many ways their own enemies. And it's this love, this compassion, this kindness, this grace that is in many ways wooing people to find and learn and understand who Jesus is. I wonder, this is what got me thinking, I wonder what would happen if I lived this way. I wonder what would happen if the church lived this way. If we began to love in this kind of radical way, I wonder if we love our government this way. I wonder if we love those who hold a different view than us this way, political view, COVID view, religious view. I wonder what would happen. I wonder what would happen if we didn't repay words with words, or criticism with criticism, or anger with anger, or ignorance with ignorance. I wonder what would happen if we actually loved and lived out this kind of love that Luke chapter 6 talks about. I wonder if we would too see a revival here in Canada. If we woke up every day and our goal was, how can I just love people around me so that I can show Jesus Christ? I wonder what would happen. Second thing that I learned when I was there, I want to challenge us with, is this. The church there, for many different reasons, they lived with this gospel awareness and this gospel urgency, and it was so inspiring. They lived with this gospel awareness and this gospel urgency that was so inspiring to me. Here's what I mean by that. Gospel awareness. The church there is confronted every day with a great need of those around them. And this need is both physical and spiritual. Financially, like I said before, because of the economic crash and because of the crisis in Lebanon, these people literally have nothing. They are on regulated electricity in Lebanon, in Beirut. The cost of goods and services, we are experiencing it here, but it does not compare to the increase of the cost in goods and services there. In many ways, it's unattainable. People's savings have been decimated. To give you a picture, we were sitting with a family, a well-off family, and they were able to save up $1 million. To me, that's like unfathomable, but they were able to save up $1 million. But when the economic crisis hit in Lebanon, that $1 million in one night turned to $50,000. That's how bad it is. Now, and they are still well off. So the dollar in the Lebanese dollar or pound or whatever it is was decimated in many ways. I mean, people there are physically poor and they are in desperate need. But not only that, they are spiritually poor. The Lebanese people don't know where to go. They don't know where to go. If you're Muslim, you're turning to Allah and Islam. But in many ways, there's no answers and there's no reprieve and there's no hope. If you're a high Catholic, you're praying and you're giving and you're striving. But there's only emptiness and a vacancy. Both of these groups are pleading. Both of them are searching. Both of them are coming up empty. And I'm telling you, there is a great disparity in Lebanon right now and in Egypt right now. However, it's the church. It's the church who has hope. It's the church who has found joy in the midst of difficulty and suffering. It is the church that know that there is more to life than here on earth, that they are not living for this world. They are living for something greater. Their hope is not in a country. It is not in foreign aid. It's not in a better tomorrow. It's not in an empty religion. Their hope is in the name of Jesus. And they are sharing this hope for people, and they are looking for opportunities to take the name of Jesus everywhere they go. They have this gospel awareness. They need to do it. And they're living with this gospel awareness. They also have this gospel urgency. They know the brevity of life. They know the brevity of time. They know the brevity of opportunity. People are desperate. People are in crisis. People are dying and dying without hope. And so the church in Lebanon, there is really no time to waste for them. There's an urgency that they live with every day of their life. And church, can I tell you this? What is true in the Meta region in Lebanon right now is also equally true for us here in Canada. However, the difference is that they are seeing this disparity and they are seeing this brevity of life, and this has caused them to live with gospel awareness and gospel urgency. And sometimes I wonder, what would God have to do in my life so that I would live with this gospel awareness and gospel urgency? Would he have to send another COVID for me to really get it? Would he have to send us into a great recession here in Canada for us to get it? Would he have to send us into another health scare? Would he have to allow us to see that our culture is moving farther and farther and farther away from Jesus? What would it take for God to open up my eyes, to make me realize I too need to live with this gospel awareness and gospel urgency? Which leads me to ask you this question. What would it take for you? What would it take for you? So church, as we've heard Jesus' words in John chapter 20, may we live the sent life. May we live this mission with a relentless pursuit. May we hear the words of Jesus when he said, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And may we live with this gospel awareness and gospel urgency in our life. I'm going to pray, and the worship team is going to sing one song as we leave this morning. Let me pray. God, I thank you for what you're doing around the world. I thank you for what you're doing through Scott and Tracy and the Blackburns. I thank you for what you're doing in Lebanon through Camille, through Bashara, through the church there. God, I pray that you would awaken us up in just the same way that there is a depravity there. There is a depravity here. But in many ways, we just don't see it. So God, I'm asking that by your Spirit, you would open our eyes. That you would allow us to see you've called us and you've sent us into this world to share the hope of Jesus. And may we live like that every single day of our life. So God, as we sing this last song, and as we wrap up this service, I pray that by your Spirit, you would stir in us. May you use this song to continue to minister to us and to speak to us. And I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
All right, we're just going to invite everyone to stand and worship with us one more time. Sing, water you turned into wine.
Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you.
Sing, our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Let's sing. Water you turn into wine.
There's no one like you.
out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is for us, who can ever stop us? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand?
Amen, church. May we live now like that. May we realize that God is awesome and He is greater. No matter what you're facing, no matter what we're going through, no matter what our world is going through, we have a Savior who is greater and mightier and stronger. And that's the God that you serve. May you leave this place realizing that you have been called. You've been sent. Sent to live with gospel awareness and a gospel urgency, so that people could hear the name and the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. God bless you. Don't run off. I mean, you're probably snowed in here anyways, so enjoy a coffee. And also, if you need prayer this morning, I would love to be able to pray with you. Russ would love to be able to pray with you. But if you do need prayer, we'd love to pray with you. God bless you. We'll see you next week.